Hi, I'm Dan Leonard in the East.
And I'm George Whittam in the West.
And together, we are
East-West Audio Body Shop.
Well, this week we have a great guest, multi-talented voice actress. She's the voice of Haley Smith on American Dad, and she does all sorts of voices on The Family Guy, and she's also in this thing called Robot Chicken. I'm too old for that, I guess. Anyway, Rachael MacFarlane will be our guest on East-West Audio Body Shop this coming Monday night, and she's some guy's sister.
I'm going to speak about soundproofing, and is it worth soundproofing your particular home studio? I'll talk about what soundproofing actually means, and is it really feasible in your particular situation, or is it just going to be so expensive that it's not cost-effective to do so?
Talk about a money pit. And in my tip of the week, we're going to talk about audiobook audio. A couple of points and tips about how to make sure your audiobook, if you're doing that kind of work, is sounding its best.
We'll also have questions you guys send in, so please send them in to ewabshop@gmail.com. You can also send us a sound question, an actual audio clip, on our website. Just click the little button on the left-hand side of the window right over at ewabs.com.
He's the home voiceover studio engineer to the stars in Los Angeles, California. A Virginia Tech grad whose knowledge of the latest recording gear is second to none. He's a voice actor and the home studio master, hailing from Buffalo, New York. His home studio skills and knowledge of voiceover recording is unmatched. When Dan and George talk shop, people listen, and the talk continues tonight. Welcome to East-West Audio Body Shop. And now, live from his high-tech facility in Santa Monica and his penthouse studio in Buffalo, here are George Whittam and Dan Leonard.
Good evening, I'm Dan Leonard in the East.
And I'm George Whittam in the West.
And together we are East-West Audio Body Shop. Well, it's another Monday night, and yeah, a few of you are out there, I guess. We like seeing a lot of people watching the show live, but of course, we know a lot of you watch the show in YouTube, and if you're watching it on YouTube, you'll go, yeah, I missed it, but I'm watching it now.
Right, but you're missing the chat room.
Yeah, really, there's tons of people in there. Best place to be. Anyway, we have, have we ever had a crappy show here? Not once that I can ever remember. Maybe episode one was just a tad weird. That was 109 episodes ago, because believe it or not, this is the 110th episode of East-West Audio Body Shop. Can you believe that?
Nope. Cannot.
I can't either.
Cannot.
You know, when we first started doing this, I'm like, yeah, we'll do it for a while, and somehow we're still here.
After a while, we're going to have to not talk about that anymore, because we'll be at 120th and 130th, and the show will just go on.
Big party when we hit 125.
Yeah, absolutely, man.
All right. So tonight, not just any night, it's Monday night, yeah, but it's also a great night to be here at East West Audio Body Shop, because we have a great guest. This gal, if you were listening to the promo, she does everything in Hollywood. In animation, she's there, because she's on Family Guy, and she's on
American Dad is her big role.
American Dad, really. She's got a great, well-known character on there, and she's working every day doing all this stuff, all sorts of different characters. Rachael MacFarlane will be our guest. Lovely lady and funny. We are going to have a great time.
And
with
being
her.
A mom at the same time.
Yeah. Yep. I want to close that door. By the way, I have a special guest in the studio tonight. You know, he's
around.
Here. Yeah, there he is. Maybe you guys recognize Lee Pinney.
Hey, Lee.
Why he's in Buffalo, we're not quite sure. He came for the wings. Came all the way from Orange, California for the wings.
Hello, man. Well, thanks for coming to be on the show and hang out with us, Lee.
Thank you.
We appreciate you having the live studio audience.
Yeah. So anyway, and see, I'm going to talk about audiobooks, and I can't even remember what you were going to talk about, but we've been busy.
Well, maybe I should just talk then.
Right. Go for it.
I'll just dive right in. Well, you know, a topic that's come up in discussion and multiple places, but especially on my live Q&A that I did last Friday for voiceover virtual that Dan was hanging out for as well. The biggest topic seemed to be that just seemed to get a lot of energy, actually, was soundproofing. And we can talk about this over and over again.
And over again.
And we'll keep talking about it because it's just that important and it needs that much attention. But I'm going to focus on a specific part of it, which is, should you soundproof? So, you know, we always talk about how you soundproof and what it means and what it does is, but should you is maybe, or maybe the why. Why would you soundproof or why you shouldn't? So, I will say that it's first of all, a lot of people think that soundproofing can be added on very inexpensively or at least affordably by tacking on some kind of material, like a layer of mass-loaded vinyl, which is like a heavy, heavy vinyl material, or, you know, some insulation on the walls, or just gluing on some kind of soundproofing magic drywall or that kind of thing. You know, that's what a lot of people think of when they think of soundproofing. But to be completely frank, it takes way more than some kind of glue-on, nail-on solution to truly soundproof a studio.
And what, it takes heavy construction equipment.
It takes heavy construction. It takes, yeah, depending on the situation, it can be incredibly laborious and costly, okay? I mean, we're talking about keeping out the sound of a jackhammer next door or right outside your house. We're talking about helicopters hovering overhead, a medevac, you know, airlifting out somebody. Exactly. We're talking, you know, there's a lot of stuff. And yeah, Jane Christopher says, is there a plug-in for soundproofing? Well, the day that happens, I'm pretty much out of a job. I don't know about you. No, I mean, there's no plug-in for soundproofing. You just have to do it with mechanical materials, construction, heavy, heavy materials, air gaps, room within a room construction. It takes an incredible amount of effort to soundproof a room. So we do our best, you know. We do little things to make a big difference whenever possible. I always say when it comes down to soundproofing, it's sort of like plugging a leaky dam. You always start with the biggest leak first. You know, you go for that big hole in the dam. You plug that in, and now you've got that stopped. You go, oh, well, there's still water leaking out over here and over here and over here and over here. And then you go work on each smaller hole until you're done. It's a little harder with sound because it sometimes can be harder to figure out where is the sound actually coming in. So should you soundproof? I find that if you are working on somebody else's schedule, for example, so let's say you work a lot where you're being directed by somebody else over Skype, over a phone, whatever, or, you know, Source Connect, ISDN, SoundStreak, any one of those things where they're going to be saying at 3 o'clock today, we're on a session. If you do that sort of work, A, I hope you're getting paid well for it, and B, then you need to consider soundproofing because now you don't have the luxury of just working around the noise. You know, normally I would say for most everybody else that's doing their own audio work on their own schedule, you're self-directing, that kind of thing, I usually say, well, if there's a noise, then stop. Or if there's a noise, take it again. You know, you work with those occasional interruptions and just, you know, roll with it. But if the noise issues you're dealing with in your particular location are so severe that it's interrupting even you can't even get in, like, you know, two paragraphs of an audiobook, for example, without interruption, then you got to consider, am I going to soundproof this space, or is there a better space that's more suitable for me to record in? Okay. These are the questions you have to ask yourself. And if you're doing audiobooks, especially if you're doing a stipend only, not stipend only, but a royalty only, where you're not even getting paid up front, is it going to make any sense at all to invest what could end up being several thousands of dollars to reduce the noise coming into your room? Or is it just not going to make sense for you? So I probably leave you with more questions than I do answers, but I do have to say it does depend on your particular situation. You do have to ask yourself a few questions. You have to ask yourself if you're ready to make it a much bigger investment in your voiceover studio. And are you going to be able to still work in that space after it's been soundproof? Is it going to be so airtight that you have no ventilation? And then you got to deal with the ventilation issue, okay? So you got to circulate air in and out of there. Dan has showed you ways to do that. We'll probably have more clips and videos on doing guerrilla-style ventilation. But these are all things that come up once you seal off a room and you make it airtight. So long form work needs ventilation. You don't have lots of chances to breathe and open a door. Short form work, you can stop more often. You can take breaks. You can work around the noises. And then work where you're being directed so that you're on somebody else's schedule. You definitely have to make that investment because you can't afford to interrupt a live session with a studio that could have 4 or 5 or even 10 plus of the client, you know, if it's a commercial, for example, hanging out and waiting for you to finish your session. So, Dan, do you do a lot of live directed sessions or are most of yours self-directed?
Well, most of the stuff I do is self-directed because I do a lot of e-learning stuff and, you know, that's my forte, and my clients know, well, that's why they hire me. They know that I'm going to do what they want. They know the basic direction. But I, you know, when I do commercials or something or a longer piece that still needs to be directed, I have a squawk box in there.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I use that really sophisticated phone patch where I'm, you know, I have to get all the equipment set up and then I go, are you all set up? Okay, let's go.
Right.
They never know. We've talked about that one before.
Sure.
But if I'm doing a live session, you know, I put the 416 in the studio and
that rejects a little bit more background noise.
My noise floor was below minus 50, minus 51, 52, which isn't bad in a fairly busy suburban neighborhood. Once I put the 416 in there, it's like under 60 and it's not even a factor anymore. So unless the dogs start barking, it's not a problem.
Right.
And if the dogs start barking, I go, excuse me, the dogs are barking.
Yeah. And if your clients can tolerate that and it doesn't bother them, then don't make the investment. I mean, these are like weird little intangible questions, but they all factor into whether you have to make that big investment in a whisper room or studio bricks or custom construction and all that kind of stuff.
If you live next to an airport.
If you live next to an airport, live.
Yeah. Now, see the thing I sent you yesterday from, I won't mention any names.
Mm-hmm.
Turns out the guy lives right off of 10. His bedroom faces 10.
Oh, the 10 freeway right here. Ouch.
We're looking at this on a waveform, on a waveform. It's like this in the silent sections, but it's like this bright red and orange in the spectrogram.
Brutal.
It's too loud. Minus 19 noise.
Whoa.
Like, you got a problem there. We got to fix that.
Oh, my gosh.
That calls for a soundproof. Or he needs to move.
I'm serious. I mean, that is sometimes, I mean, depending on your situation, it could end up being the best case scenario is to move. I know for many people, that's not a realistic solution. But if you're looking at spending a tremendous amount of money where you were considering moving anyway, or, you know, you might be moving somewhere down the road, don't do it until you have to.
Right.
All right. Beat that one. Beat it dead.
Well, yeah. See, I'm gonna have to do the one on ventilation again.
Because yep.
I had to invent my entire own ventilation system for this guy over here.
Exactly.
It works really, really well. But it's not airtight and it's not sound tight, but it's still better than, you know, than most things.
Exactly.
Unless I'm on the flight path some afternoons, which is a problem sometimes. Although yesterday, and then we'll move on here, but I was trying to record something, and some guy in a stunt plane decided, I guess he had to land over at Buffalo International, but there must have been a couple other planes coming in, so he starts circling in this, you know, with a loud radial engine over the house.
Oh, yeah, that's a little taste of what it's like to live in my neighborhood.
I know, it sounded just like your backyard, and I hear this plane going around, and I'm looking at it, and you can see it on the waveform, and you can see it in the spectrogram, how it gets brighter as he's circling around and throttling up. It was about 10 minutes he was circling around. I'm like, I go out in my driveway and I'm like, watching this guy. This guy's probably watching me in my driveway. And he's
exactly.
Anyway, that's the time you need a soundproof booth. Or you have to have patience.
Both of you have to have patience.
That's true.
That's right.
Anyway, all right. Well, we have Rachael MacFarlane come on. We don't want to keep her because she's got other things to do, and we still have to do tip of the week and all sorts of other stuff. So don't go anywhere. Stay where you are. We'll be right back here on East West Audio Body Shop.
This is East West Audio Body Shop, where Dan and George don't speak geek.
You know, we definitely don't speak geek. You know, that was Larry Davis's girlfriend. They get married yet?
you got to take your time and to do things right once in a while, you know?
Yeah. I was watching the Bills game yesterday, and who's doing the voice for CBS Sports? I'm like, it sounds like Morgan Freeman. No, wait, it's Larry Davis.
Oh, is that right? Was he doing his storyteller?
I'm pretty sure it was Larry Davis, yeah.
Awesome.
That was kind of cool. Because he sort of sounded like Morgan Freeman, but wasn't quite Morgan Freeman. Then it's got to be Larry Davis.
Awesome.
Who sort of sounds like Morgan Freeman anyway.
Sort of sounds like a little bit.
A little bit. Anyway, well, tip of the week this week. Interesting discussion. Now, I made this a while ago, and I've had some different opinions about audiobooks since, but let's roll this and then we can continue the conversation. Here's my tip of the week.
The Rice region, of course, transcended state boundaries. Its heart stretched along the low country on both sides of the Georgia-South Carolina border, and many planter families owned properties in both states. But in 1876, there was a fundamental difference.
Oh, hi. You know, I'm getting a lot of emails each week asking me how to record and process audiobooks. It's a whole new world. Audiobooks are big. Everybody wants in. Until they're in. A little intimidating? Well, the requirements for what's needed for an audiobook, unfortunately, are kind of subjective. Each publisher has their own criteria.
Things have changed a great deal for the industry. While some big publishers still have talent come to a studio and be directed, the majority of work is being done at home, and unfortunately at unprofitable rates. No director, just you, 400 pages, and your microphone. So, how do you handle all this new stuff? Well, first off, don't be intimidated. Recording an audiobook is the same as recording anything else. Set your levels, hit record, and start reading. If you record your voice properly, with the proper levels, in the proper acoustical environment, you're 80% there. So, let's talk about editing. Editing precisely with choices to edit with. Here's what I and many others do. If you make a mistake, don't stop. Just keep it rolling. Make a mark, either physically using the M key, or make a distinctive quick loud noise like or beep, or use a clicker. When you finish the chapter, go back visually only and edit the mistakes using the best take marked on the waveform. The more you edit, the faster you'll get at it. Watch how I edit this section of this book that I'm actually working on right now, Nothing But Freedom by Eric Foner. Republican political power, after all, had helped create the context in which successful collective action was possible. Nowhere was the difference made by Reconstruction more evident than in the Rice Kingdom itself during 1876. The Rice region, of course, transcended state but transcended state boundaries. Its heart stretched along the low country on both sides of the Georgia-South Carolina border, and many planter families owned properties in both states. But in 1876, there was a fundamental difference. South Carolina was still under Republican control, while Georgia had been redeemed. Now, watch how I edit this. I'm going to go through it. I'm going to find consonants to work with. I'm going to zoom in, and that's how we're going to edit this.
Nowhere was the difference.
Zoom in. Find the beginning of the word. And tighten it up. Zoom out.
Transcended state boundaries.
Next mistake. The first mistake. Line it up. tighten it up, get rid of the breath.
And many planters
mistake. Zoom in for tightness. Do it on a consonant here at the P.
And many planter families owned.
Makes for a seamless edit. Get rid of that little noise. Find the mistake.
Well, Georgia.
Line it up. And let's see what it sounds like.
Republican political power, after all, had helped create the context in which successful collective action was possible. Nowhere was the difference made by Reconstruction more evident than in the Rice Kingdom itself during 1876. The Rice region, of course, transcended state boundaries. Its heart stretched along the Lowcountry on both sides of the Georgia-South Carolina border, and many planter families owned properties in both states. But in 1876, there was a fundamental difference. South Carolina was still under Republican control, while Georgia had been redeemed.
And that's all there is to it. Don't be intimidated. You don't have to do anything special right now. We'll teach you everything else you need to learn about recording audiobooks. But just set your levels, read the way you normally would, and edit the way you normally would. And that's my tip of the week.
Yeah, you know, and since I did that, I sort of gave up on audiobooks for the time being. You know, until the money's really good, until there's actually good stuff to record. I mean, that was a really good book. That was the last historical book that I did, because I don't do fiction. If I did fiction, it would take me a year, because I'd concentrate on the characters. I would create background noise, and people, no, we don't want that. We just
be doing a radio play.
I'd make a radio play out of it. I'm too auditory, and you know that's just the way it is. So, also being a history major, it was fun to do historical novels and one on philosophy that I still don't understand, but people are still buying it. So, anyway, but I've done over 40 audiobooks, and I just don't want to do it anymore. But if someone offers me a good one, maybe I'll do it. And yeah. If I do it, I'll still use Twisted Wave and I'll still edit that way.
Yeah, never say never, but it's not right for everybody. That's very clear.
Yeah, it's I have my problems with the audiobook industry, and I know a lot of people know what I think about it, and I'm just not doing them for the time being. Yep. But that leaves them all for you guys to do.
That's right.
You know, I make jokes about it, if you're doing audiobooks, again, stock up on the ramen noodles and the mac and cheese.
Right.
Because I don't know how you make a living doing that, unless you're Scott Brick or Simon Vance, who's a wonderful guy.
Mm-hmm.
Gotta love Simon Vance. Just a wonderful guy. And is Scott Brick. Both great guys, because they both give back. But unless you're in that caliber, it's a lot of work. High work, low reward. I don't know. I'm probably ticking off probably about 40% of our audience right now. But yeah. Or they're thrilled. Hey, Dan's not doing it. Now I can do it.
You know, they can start their own show and they can talk about how great doing audiobooks is. Oh, no, wait a minute. They can't do that because they're too damn busy recording right now.
Yeah. Still editing chapter 4. Anyway, well, the show continues here, and we have a great guest coming up who you do not want to miss, because this is going to be one of the most fun 20 minutes you're ever going to spend here at East West Audio Body Shop. Rachael MacFarlane will be joining us, so don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with her in 60 seconds.
VO Studio Tech. Recording made simple.
Hi, I'm Peter McHugh.
This is Jim Tasker from Los Angeles, California.
Hi, this is Bill Ratner in Los Angeles.
Hi, this is Scott Rummel here in Yorba Linda, California.
Hi, my name is Rick Wasserman.
Hi, this is Tom Kane.
Hi, my name is Vanessa Marshall.
Hi, my name is Zurich.
Hi, I'm Mary McKittrick.
Randy Thomas chiming in.
Hi, this is Joe Szymanski.
Hey, this is Rick Robles.
Hi, my name is John Patrick Armstrong.
I was turned on to George by none other than Don LaFontaine, who always swore by his health.
George is absolutely awesome.
ISDN, Source Connect, Phone Patch, FTP, you name it, Georgia set it up.
It's really the best thing I've ever done for myself. I feel free, safe, fearless, like anything is possible in here.
Unless you like to look for opportunities to waste time, call George.
And he did all of that, long distance over the phone and the internet.
I'm very happy with George, and I cherish him.
Thanks, George. You make it easy.
Welcome back to EWABS. We were expecting you, but we still didn't bake a cake. Here's Dan and George.
But my wife made a wonderful peach cobbler over the weekend. None of you could have. I had it all to myself. Anyway, we'd like to welcome to our show somebody who we've wanted to have on for a long time because she does everything. She is on, you know, American Dad, Family Guy, all this great stuff. She's there, and she does these great voices, and we want to find out how she does it, why she does it, and where she does it.
And what she wears when she does it.
And what she wears when she does it. Rachael MacFarlane, welcome to East West Audio Body Shop.
Hi.
Hi there.
Wow, I didn't know that was going to be this type of interview.
That was so funny. When you said, hi, it froze on your face and that expression.
Was that Jennifer Hale doing the little intro there?
No, that was not Jennifer Hale. That was
Elizabeth.
Like that. Oh, what's Elizabeth's last name?
I don't know.
She's a friend of the show.
Offending multiple people.
A friend of the show, but she's a multi-talented kind of voice
she
actor.
Sounds so much like Jen. Wow. That's
funny. Look out, Jen. Look out.
Yeah. All you women sound
she's
alike.
Coming for you.
Was Jennifer voicing the Emmys last night?
I don't know.
Who was that?
God, I totally didn't watch the Emmys. You know what? I was just catching up online, actually. Isn't that awful? I didn't watch the Emmys.
You're so Hollywood that you didn't even watch the Emmys.
No, you know what it is? I'm too big of a football fan. That's
right. I saw your tweets about the football, actually, while I was watching.
Oh, really? I know. It was just, I mean, it's not that I'm a Bears fan. I'm a Pats fan. But that was insane. I don't know if anybody watched that game. But there were a lot of turnovers.
Yes. Anyway, back to voiceover.
Yeah.
Very, very, very.
Back to voiceover.
Or voice acting, probably more appropriate. You're doing a lot of stuff here. Now, people know you for, you know, American Dad and the Family Guy and some guy you're related to who does some of this stuff, too.
That's right.
Now, we've had a lot of people who do cartoon stuff and animation, but you're really up there. What's it like being in a big, successful show like that?
Yeah, I mean, it's funny. It hasn't always felt like being part of a big, successful show. I mean, we love Fox. Obviously, they've kept us on the air for going on 8 years. But we've always been kind of the redheaded stepchild of Family Guy. You know what I mean? We've always felt like we're on the brink of cancellation. Anybody that, you know, obviously works in this industry knows what that feels like. We're literally like, oh my God, are we going to get a pickup every year? But for some reason, they have, you know, left us alone, left us in that same time slot, and other shows have come and gone, and we're still there. And it's actually been an incredible experience. It's been a blast. I've got an incredible cast. I mean, you know, Wendy and Dee and Scott. I mean, these people are cream of the crop.
Yeah.
And it's also a really good show. I mean, you know, if I may, you know, toot the horn of everybody that's involved. It's a really good show. My funny little sidebar here. My father is the president of my brother's fan club.
The actual president?
That's the awesome. Actual president.
Like, gavel and everything?
He gets all the mail and he sits there, you know, like a couple days a month and he answers letters. And
that's,
you know,
sweet. That's a proud dad.
It is. I know. But the funny thing is that in recent years, he says American Dad gets more fan mail than Family Guy. So, it's definitely
sibling. Yeah. No, I'm not going to speak tonight.
Sibling rivalry.
Yes.
Yes. No, it's awesome. I mean, I love our show. We actually just started recording, which is for us season 9, I think for everybody else season 10, last week. So we just dug into a new season.
Yeah. So you're like a year ahead when you record this stuff, right?
Yeah.
So when someone says, well, what's going to happen? You're like,
Every year at Comic-Con, it's the same thing. You know, we get to that panel and tell us what's coming up this season. And we're all like, what did we do? I have no idea what's coming up this season.
I can't remember.
When you work in the studio, are you working with the other actors in the same room? Are you doing a lot of stuff together or are you really just recording your own lines on your own?
Yeah, it's mostly wild. I mean, we get the table read to play off each other, which is so much fun.
I'm sure.
It's the thing that we all look forward to. It's when we all get to see each other. We get to hear how it's going to play off of each other. And then 2 days later, we're in the booth by ourselves. Yeah, recording the lines wild. It amazes me when I watch those episodes that we weren't all in the same room together, though, because the editors are incredible. It sounds that way.
Right. And you're
being, you know what, Family Guy, back in the very beginning of Family Guy, back in 99, probably, we would record in the same room. And it was so much fun, but I think it was such a time suck because we were just laughing so hard.
Oh, you ruined it.
That it would take ever to get an episode done. I mean, seriously, I remember this one time, literally like hunched over on the floor, just weeping. I was laughing so hard and not being able to put together. I mean, that record took like way more time than
it
was.
So we had June Foray on, and now I know what she meant by we were professionals.
Yeah,
because they could sit in the same room together and they could make it all the way through their script and they never lost composure.
Wendy Shawl is our biggest defender at our table reads. Sometimes she will lose her shit and not be able to pull it back together. And like, it's just, everybody laughs for a while and then it's like, okay, all right, come on now. It's time. We got to get going.
Professionals.
But it's, I mean, like, it's moments like that that I think I have the most fun job in the world. I really do. So much fun.
Do you get to really work on your characters where you can make suggestions to the writers about how things work? Or do you really get it? Do you really, you know, where is your motivation coming
from?
Like an
arc, maybe a story arc or
kind of. Yeah. I mean, I think with a show like American Dad, where we've been doing it for close to a decade at this point, we definitely have a lot of say. And the co-creators, Mike Barker and Matt White, men are these incredible guys. We're all good friends. And absolutely, if I come to them with a story idea, you know, or, and actually Mike will often call me and say, hey, we're thinking about, you know, Haley, you know, whatever, moving on from Jeff Fisher, or we're thinking about maybe Haley gets a job here or Haley does this. And so they do run those ideas by us. And, you know, last year when Haley sort of took her turn as a singer, that was, you know, I wanted to release my record, and we thought that American Dad would be a good platform to, you know, sort of propel that. So I said to the guys, you know, can we work this in? And they were more than willing to sort of craft that storyline, which is great.
Yeah, well, it's fun to watch. You know, I can remember being in the hospital and thinking there's got to be something on, and thank God there was an American Dad marathon.
Oh, man. I'm
glad we could get you through that.
I'll take because I did not want to be there. I'm like, thank God, something funny's on. But anyway.
I'm like, oh, thank God. Thank God Family Guy's on. Thank God American Dad's on.
Yeah, absolutely.
Go ahead, Dan.
Go ahead,
Jerry. I want to ask a question. Maybe you were going to ask this. I don't know. Dan and I don't review our questions before the show. It's more spontaneous.
No, we just bring it in.
AKA, we don't do preparation. But, you know, your brother, Seth MacFarlane.
Who?
Yes. Would you have gotten into voiceover? Did it really pique your interest at all if he hadn't kind of almost in a literal way dragged you into the business the way he sort of did in the beginning?
Yeah, it's a really interesting situation. I mean, no, I was a musical theater major in college and thought I was Broadway bound. And, you know, I wasn't enjoying it as much as I thought I would in New York. And I came out here on a vacation in 1998 to visit Seth. Family Guy was in its infancy. And he said, what are you going back to New York for? And I said, I feel like I should give this another shot. And he said, I think you'd be really good at voiceover. I mean, he and I have been playing around at this sort of stuff since we were five. He said, I think you should give it a shot. I want you to come and do a Family Guy table read, and I want you to play this character, Jennifer the Cult Girl, which was, I think, the second episode of Family Guy. So I said, one, I'd never, literally never considered voiceover, ever. And I went and did the table read, and it was a blast. And the casting director there, who I still work with, she still casts American Dad and Family Guy, said, we want you to have this role, and we're going to help you get your SAG card and get an agent. And it was, you know, when people ask, how did I get into this? It's ridiculous. You know, I mean, I had somebody hold my hand, you know, it's kind of unfair.
But I mean, at the time, the show wasn't like a huge hit or anything.
It hadn't aired yet.
Yeah. It was, you were still kind of like, okay.
I remember sitting on the floor of Seth's Glendale apartment when it aired with a bunch of friends on that Super Bowl Sunday thinking, oh my God, is this going to fly? Are people going to think this is funny? It's crazy. It's crazy how much time has passed since then, really.
Mm.
Yeah. Really.
Well, but you're aside from being a full-time actress, you're also now a full-time mom, aren't you?
I am. Yes.
How do you mix that? We have a lot of people on the show who, you know, have young kids, some with slightly older kids. But if you're a young mother or you're a young family, how do you balance that? What's your day like, and are you working around it or what?
Yeah. I mean, it's part of what I think I love the most about my career is the flexibility that it affords me. We really, you know, this, we get to make our own schedules for the most part. And most of the shows that I work on, you know, even outside of the stuff I do on Fox, you know, the stuff I do at Warner Brothers and Disney and Cartoon Network, they're really flexible, you know, about working with your schedule. And my priority, I mean, I'm sure everybody gives this answer. My priority is my family and my kid, and I want to spend as much time with her as possible. So, with the singing career this past year, with all the time that I devoted to that, I did a lot of traveling, some touring. That was hard. That was really hard. And ultimately, it sort of became too much time away from home, too much time away from home. So, you know, but the great thing is, thanks to George, I have a wonderful little recording studio in my closet.
Tell us about it.
I buy lots of clothes often to keep, you know, sound really good. That's what I tell my husband. I had to get this, honey. You know,
that's right.
I need the sound to be, you know, better in there. I do most of my auditioning from home. I've booked a lot of jobs from my closet, which is great.
Yeah,
absolutely. It's really simple. I mean, George can probably tell you more about it than I can.
I can't remember what the microphone is right now.
I have no idea. All I know is that I went to the Guitar Center and they sold me a pretty decent.
Right, right.
Yes, yes. The rule is when you walk into Banjo Emporium, never go in there not knowing what you want.
Oh, yeah.
No, I have a big sign that says Target on my back whenever I walk into an electronics store. So I'm sure he sold me a microphone that does far more than I needed to do. No, but when George found me in my closet, my system was really pretty bad. I, you know, had a microphone but wasn't using it. It was clearly recording through my computer's microphone. It's awful.
But you're not too embarrassed. You're saying it right here in front of tens of people.
Tens of people.
Tens of people now know that I am absolutely computer illiterate. Yeah, I can barely use a phone.
That's because you're focusing on being an actor. That's what I always say to people to make them feel better.
An actor, yes.
Yeah. Actor. So you like to be known as an actor these days, right? Not an actress.
Yeah, I guess that is what. That is what we do, right? We are. We're actors. We're serious actors.
Yeah.
Yes. Sure. No one calls anyone a voice actress.
Some of us more serious than others.
Yeah. Exactly.
I guess.
Yeah. So what's your typical day like then?
Gosh. Well,
start
let's
from
see.
Waking up and the coffee and the juice.
Here we go. I'm currently training for a 10K. I'm not a runner.
Wow.
So my typical day, like let's take Wednesday this week, for example, I will get up at 7 a.m. I will have my coffee. I will get my kid ready for school. I will take her to school, drop her off, go for a run. And then come home and get ready to go to my table read. And then I'll go to my table read, which will take – it all depends on whether or not Seth is going to participate. If he's not participating, it starts on time. We're good. We're in and out of there in an hour.
Oh, he's that kind of a diva, huh?
He is participating. Oh, God. I don't know. 2.5 hours. Like, we'll sit there for an hour just shooting the shit. And, you know, there. Is he home? Is he getting on the phone? It's okay. Everybody knows this. He's chronically late. On a good day, it'll take an hour. And then I'll go home. And while my daughter's napping, I'll scoot into the closet and do some auditions. And, that's pretty much a typical day for me. Shoot to the mall, get a foot massage. I don't know. What?
These were the details we wanted. This is the real meat of the matter.
Juicy stuff.
There you go.
And how often, how many days a week are you at the studio doing?
The mall, getting a foot massage? I don't know. Yeah. Wait, ask again? What?
No, how many days a week are you actually shooting, or so to speak, shooting?
2 days, Wednesdays and Fridays for American Dad, and then, whatever else comes up during the week. You know, it's hard. It's everybody who does voiceover knows it's hard to plan because you can get a call the night before for something, and then all of a sudden you have to rearrange your schedule.
What kind of other work are you gunning for?
Well, funny you should ask. I mean, obviously my bread and butter is animation, and mm-hmm. I love it. But I don't know. Recently, I've actually been wanting to do some more like commercial voiceover and TV stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm actually going to take a class this year.
Great.
Never taken a class. I'm really excited about that.
You're going to learn a lot.
Workshop. Yeah. And try to kind of extend this a little bit and see how far reaching it can be.
Yeah. Now, you're also doing some producing. I find it when there's a show that's really successful, suddenly you start watching the credits and everybody who's on the show is now one of the producers.
I know.
How does that happen?
American Dad. It's because they realize that they can make more money than just having a writer credit, right?
Right.
Right to produce. Now, I think obviously anybody that is an actor knows that even while one project is going on, you have to have the next thing lined up.
The irons in the fire.
Exactly, the irons in the fire. So, I'm sort of dabbling in show creating and a little bit of writing and a little bit of producing. And hopefully the next time I talk to you guys, one of those things will have materialized into something significant.
And we will have you on to push it as hard as you can.
Thank you.
That's right.
Yes, let's hope. Yes, I've got a couple of really exciting projects going right now that I wish I could talk about, but I can't.
All right. Then we won't ask.
We didn't ask you this, but Kathy, our producer, asked.
Yeah, I was. Yeah, we're gonna. This is totally unprofessional. This is not what
Never.
We do. But since Kathy's asking,
Ever.
We'll just let it
Anything
go.
Anything for Kathy.
Yeah, she wants you to do your Hillary voice.
My what? Who the hell is Hillary? Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, see if you can do Hillary Clinton,
dude. Did you just fuck up the name of my American Dad character?
Catherine did. I'm just reading what's written here. It's Haley, you
it's
dean.
Haley.
Did you even
Obviously,
watch,
she
you,
doesn't you watch even, the show.
Did you even watch that marathon?
No.
I think I screwed
it
up.
I was just reading it. I knew it was Hillary.
I'm going to own it. I screwed up a lower third. And I think somebody saw it. I'm embarrassed.
Okay.
Oh, it was your fault. See,
yep.
I knew it was
Haley.
It was
my fault.
Why is everybody writing Hillary
It
here?
Was my fault. I put it on the
all
lower
right,
third.
Joe, we're gonna move past this. We're all adults here.
Breathing. Breathing.
Breathing. Move on.
I've been sick. Thank you.
Here's the thing about Hillary. You know, when I went in for that audition, the guys, Mike and Matt, they said, we just want her to sound like you. So I have to say, I think I have one of the easiest jobs in voiceover when I do American Dad, because with a slight tweak, it's pretty much what you're hearing, you know?
Mm-hmm.
She kind of sounds like, Dad, oh my God, I can't believe you won't let Jess stay for dinner again. Ugh, that's Haley.
That's awesome. That's the dream job. Are you kidding me?
Incredible. No, really. And I was doing a lot of cartoony stuff at that point, too. A lot mm-hmm. of, you know, like Codename Kids Next Door and The Grim Adventures of Billy and Mandy and, you know. And I went in there ready, you know, and they were like, no, we just wanted to sound like you. So it's pretty great.
So it's just acting.
It is just acting. Very serious business, what I do.
But you do a lot of other character stuff on a lot of other stuff.
I do. You know, one of the projects I was working on over the last couple years that I'm so sad people aren't going to see for a long time is Seth Green's show Detours. I'm sure you've heard about that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was playing Cy Snoodles. You know who that character is from the Star Wars? No? She's the lead singer in the band.
Oh, the cabaret.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. It was so much fun, and she was such an out there character, and I was having such a blast playing her. So hopefully people will get to see that eventually. And I'm doing the new Tom and Jerry series right now too, which has been really fun. Playing
still talking in that though.
Okay. So if you remember the old episode, there were these two witch characters, these headless witches. Do you remember these? They were like sort of the arsenic and old lace lady.
Right.
It's Cree Summer and I playing these two witches, and
cool.
We're having a blast with these characters. They're so much fun. So I do get to stretch in other areas, and on American Dad, I get to play a lot of incidentals. You know, we've got a cast of five, and then they hire a couple of other people to come in, but I'm always old lady number two or, you know, girl number one. Girl number one is my favorite character on Family Guy that I get to play on a regular basis.
What does she sound like?
You know, whatever they need. A whore, an old woman. I actually have an episode of Family Guy coming up that I'm guest starring in where I play, this is so strange, I play Quagmire's love interest. Yeah, she's really nasty. It's like she's like Quagmire as a woman.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
That's going to be funny.
It is, but it's also really weird, you know? I mean, like, they cast me and I went in and I did it, and then I think we were at Comic-Con and people started pointing out how strange it was, and it is.
But they keep watching.
We don't record in the same room.
Should we jump to some fan questions, Dan? Fan questions?
Yeah, well, I mean, she's answered all of these.
Yeah, she pretty much
does. Does she do auditions from home?
I know.
Let's see. Do you do more than just animation? She answered any commercial work that we would recognize. If there had been, what's a commercial you've done?
Not yet.
You know, has being the sister of Seth hurt her, helped your career? She talked about that.
I know, man. We're checking off all the boxes tonight.
Let's see.
Devox did say, "What can you explain her chain?" Which you probably have no idea what I'm talking about when I say that. Explain her chain.
Your audio chain.
For Devox,
microphone computer.
It's basically a mic going into an M-Box going into a MacBook. Twister Wave. That's it.
I mean, that's,
and there you go.
Oh, I designed it. I mean, the mic box and the computer thing and the wires and the headphones and the, you know, plug.
And you're used to, well, I'll be a little bit techie. You're used to monitoring yourself in your headphones, right? As opposed to working without.
Yes, I am. I prefer headphones.
Who are you listening to?
Hmm?
Who are you listening to?
Listening to myself.
See, that's like a big voice. When you work with a voice coach, I guarantee they're going to make you take off your headphones and do voice acting without headphones.
Yeah, it's okay. I don't really enjoy it as much, but yes, you're probably right. I know. I like to hear me.
Yeah. I mean, if you're good at hearing yourself, then you can do that, obviously.
Right.
You know, it's definitely something that changes the way. I have clients that have been doing promo and that kind of stuff for years, and then they all of a sudden try it. And they go, oh my God.
Wow, right. For that sort of stuff, it seems like it would be really tricky. I mean, you really have to have it. Yeah.
Yeah.
You really need to hear yourself there.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, when you're listening to other elements and stuff like that, or a director, or somebody who's in another room, you got to have headphones. But other than that, just listen to yourself in the environment in which you're in. You'll notice I'm not wearing headphones.
No, you're not.
He's cheating. He's supposed to be wearing headphones.
I'm supposed to be wearing headphones. We have a guest, and he wouldn't be able to hear unless...
I'm one of those people that records like this all the time.
Okay, all right. Then you leave one ear. That's good. All right. Well, I guess we'll leave it at that then.
I think it looks cool and, you know, like, yeah.
Absolutely.
Like, I'm doing We Are the World. Sorry. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I know. Well, I know you're a busy lady. You have, you know, cakes to bake and cookies to make and things like that.
Of course. Kids to put to bed, stories to read.
All that kind of stuff. But we really, 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 really appreciate you taking the time to come with us on our little show here and making our Monday evening so darn pleasant.
It is my pleasure, and we're so lucky that the Patriots weren't playing tonight too, so that we
can.
And thank your husband for, you know, circuitous. Oh man, I'm mad in 1,000 tonight. For basically hooking you and me up, you know.
I was asking him tonight. I know him. Tell me that chain of events again.
Way back. I mean, way before I moved to L.A. He was in Philly and I was in Philly, and we had mutual friends. And
you did. You had your mutual musician friends.
That's right. That's right. And you know, we both ended up out here, and now I've been out here 9 years, and I've still not had a chance to actually press the flesh. We've been in. You guys might as well be 4 hours away.
I know. It's crazy, right?
You know, that's how L.A. is laid out.
You know, your buddy wrote a song for my husband in college. Do you know this?
Aaron?
And it was called
Aaron Munch?
Yes, it was Aaron. And it was called Take a Spencer 10, and it's an hour long. That's how my husband is at everything that he does.
Awesome. Thank you so
much.
Like
Alice's restaurant.
There we go.
Thank you.
Well, Rachael, thanks so much for being with us tonight.
Guys.
It's been absolute pleasure, and it's been a laugh riot since we started talking an hour ago.
Thanks for teaching me how to use Skype. It's so exciting.
Oh, my day is fulfilled.
You like utterly broadened my horizons tonight. It's amazing.
Ahmed, you can talk to anybody who has Skype anywhere in the world for free.
It's incredible. All of my relatives in China.
Absolutely.
Yes.
You know, now the government will listen in, but you know, but you'll be able to talk to them.
Oh yeah.
Awesome. All right.
Well,
thanks for being with us, and say hello to all your family, and watch our show when we're on.
Every I will.
Night.
I will.
All right.
Thanks, guys.
Excellent.
See you, Rachael.
Have a good night.
Bye.
Rachael MacFarlane joining us here on East West Audio Body Shop. Well, we got to wrap things up in a little bit. We still got a few things to talk about, so we'll be right back. Don't go away yet.
Hi, I'm Dave Courvoisier. You know, these days, to get anything accomplished in your voiceover business, you've got to spend some time online. We audition online, we share with others, and on
VoiceOver Extra, the voiceover industry's online news, education, and resource center 24/7. Hundreds, probably thousands of free how-to articles for voiceover success, ranging from home studio to voice acting to business. A free voiceover industry directory, calendar of industry events, resource links, a store, and much more. Bi-monthly webinars on all topics of voiceover, free subscriptions to newsletters, reports, announcements, daily news, and features at voiceoverextra.com.
Now back to EWABS. Thank Dan and George's wives. For what? You have no idea. Now, here's Dan and George.
Yeah, speaking of Larry Davis. All right, we're back here at East West Audio Body Shop. And why am I so far away? Because we want to talk about something very special that our good friend Harlan Hogan has over at voiceoveressentials.com. Yes, you've seen them, and here it is. I've been trying to find a replacement light for this for the longest time. I finally found something. You can modify this thing and use it. Here's my voiceover trophy, which I haven't won yet. Here you see the voiceover recording sign. You can get these at voiceoveressentials.com. And do I need to lower the camera a little bit there?
No, I'm cropping in. Don't move it. Don't move it.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'll just move the camera back.
I'm cropping it in.
We'll just keep moving around and trying to distract you.
Got it.
Okay. Recrop it. Here we go.
There you go. I got it. Trust me.
Oh, there we go. Okay. Here it is. The voiceover recording sign. How much are these things? We've got to go on the website and figure out this.
I believe they're like $79.
$79, but you can modify it. You can have it start talking to you. It's all sorts of stuff. But if you go over to voiceoveressentials.com, this is one of the most popular items he has over there.
$74.95 or $85 with the remote switch.
With the remote switch. And guess what? Because I have the remote switch, I can turn it on and off at will. How do you like that?
That's cool. I mean, you guys, we were talking about soundproofing. This is the perfect product to mention because you guys, many of you, are going to have to just tell everybody in the house to shut up. And this is sort of a nice way of doing that. Now, of course, you have to train them somehow so that when the sign turns on, they shut up. So that's your job to figure out. But
you hang this outside your door, and there you go. So, and that's that. VoiceOverEssentials.com. Get your sign.
Now. At voiceoveressentials.com. Thanks, Harlan.
Thank you, Harlan.
You the man.
He absolutely is. To come up with something like that.
I know.
All righty.
Well, Edge is a sponsor, too. I'll say thank you to Edge. I ran my spot for VO Studio Tech. If you guys are wondering, like, what's going on with VO Studio Tech?
What's going on with VO Studio
Tech? It's kind of a long story, but we're going through this transitional phase. It's kind of complicated. We're building a whole new website. And in the process, then we'll kind of integrate my world with the Edge world and all this stuff. So it's a little frustrating right now because I'm with Edge. I'm absolutely with Edge. But if you want to get my tech help, you got to go over to vostudiotech.com. So we're kind of like buddy up right now, but we're going to have the two worlds fully integrated probably by the end of the year. So for now, if you are looking for tech support stuff, that's vostudiotech.com. And if you're looking for coaching or production or voiceover demo production, that kind of stuff, go over to edgestudio.com. And that's about all I got to say until we get a cool commercial to run on here.
Yeah. We've asked them.
You're working. You know, working this website has been an all-encompassing project. I mean, imagine, I don't know if you've seen edgestudio.com. It's a pretty complicated website, right? I mean, they're trying to recreate it a totally different way. I think, like, right now the website's built on, like, Drupal or something. You know, and it's one of those things that if you want to update, like, you know, a little bit of text or change a logo, you have to be a complete computer genius to do it, right? So they're changing it out so the website can be a little bit more sensible to edit. You know, like you would a Wikipedia site, something, not Wikipedia. What's the site?
WordPress.
Like a WordPress site.
I got it right. All
Thank
right.
you. Thank you for being my brain tonight.
It's my pleasure.
I'm also on acetaminophen. I rarely take pharmaceuticals. So it's like, you know, it's effective and it also makes me a little loopy. So anyway.
You don't take any pharmaceuticals?
I rarely do.
Do you think I keep it together like this without them?
Man, it's getting increasingly hard. I'll be 40 years old in less than a month. I think I'll start using a little bit more pharmaceuticals.
You're a kid.
I know, but you ask my dad. It's like, it's crazy. It's crazy talk. I remember being at my dad's 40th birthday. We videotaped the whole thing. And it was a surprise party. I remember being there. I'm on the you know,
VHS,
you can see me.
Probably.
Yeah, VHS. It was unbelievable. Actually, I think it was a Kodak 8mm video tape camera. It was cutting edge. Anyway, whew, wild stuff. Should we blast through that question that came in, or that multifaceted question? Do we have time?
Yeah. Okay, go ahead. What was the question? I think it was from.
I don't remember.
It was from
Robert.
Robert
Leach.
Bob Leach wrote into us.
I will read it as quickly as I can. George, I recall in EWABS a while back you demonstrated a high-end headset mic used on the last Les Mis film.
And Les Miserables.
And I think you suggested it might be acceptable for audiobooks. Do you ever see Key and Peele on Comedy Central? Have you ever seen these?
Yeah, this duo?
They do a Les Mis bit. Is crazy. It is so funny. Anyway, I was thinking of something like that, possibly the Rode version of the headset for auditioning in acoustically poor spaces when I'm away from the studio. I need something low profile, good off-axis rejection from fans, blah, blah, blah. Is this a viable option? Am I correct in assuming a directional type capsule would be better than an Omni? What brands do you recommend? And am I barking up the wrong tree entirely?
Yeah, he's just looking to buy stuff.
You know, it's funny. I haven't been using the headset mic for a while, have I? I don't know. It's an interesting take on a voiceover mic. Is it like the perfect travel mic and a mic to use when you're not in a good acoustical space? I don't think so. But I mean, I think I would need to experiment with it a bit. You know what? I bought another one recently because, you know, the Rode mic, while relatively affordable, is still like a $300 mic. And for something that you want to experiment with, it's a little on the pricey side. But I found, and the Rode mic arguably is sort of a cheap, kind of a knockoff of a more expensive mic. I basically found a mic that is a knockoff of that. So it's even cheaper. And it's made by Pyle, P-Y-L-E. You've probably heard of them. They make really inexpensive car stereos and like DJ. I got two mics tangled together here. This is hilarious. They make really inexpensive equipment for DJs, sound systems, that kind of stuff. But they're selling a headset mic. This is what it looks like. Oh, my God. Okay, they're selling a headset mic. This is what it looks like. So it has that same wrap around the back of the head kind of look. It's not particularly adjustable, but you can move the mic back and forth to get the position you want. I think it's like $16 on Amazon. Okay. I mean, it's like stupid cheap. The expensive part, and this is being relative, is the adapter to plug it into a mixer. Okay. So you need this little guy. It's the power supply phantom power adapter to power the headset because it's normally plugged into a wireless microphone system. This thing I found also, I think on Amazon, was like $40. And these are normally like at least 100. So this is the YPA A65P, this little thing. That's definitely the hardest thing to find, okay? But that takes the, I can get it apart. That takes the 4-pin mini connector that's on the mic and adapts it to XLR, okay? Put it all together, you're talking a $60 headset mic that you can plug into a professional interface. Go get one. Go give it a try. For $60, how can you lose?
What do you got to lose?
I played with it quite a bit. I thought it sounded quite serviceable. Is it good enough for audiobooks? I'd say yes. I think the bar for audiobook quality is not as high as many other kinds of voiceover. It's all about low noise. But I found it to be acceptably low noise. But these mics are all omnidirectional, so they do pick up in all directions. The reasons why they work so well is because the microphone element itself, when it's put on your head, is really close to your mouth. You know, it's like an inch away, maybe 2 inches. And because it's so close, you can run it at a lower gain, so then it picks up less background noise and echo. But again, I think you're going to have to experiment and try it out. And for that kind of a price, you know, report back to us. Grab one and give it a go. I'd be curious to see what you find out.
All right. Well, that answers that question. Bring the one about the noise floor on next week. That was...
Oh, yeah. Oh, definitely.
To show you the picture of what that looked like.
Definitely.
Anyway.
What's coming up?
We
got a donor again.
What?
We got our like most loyal donor ever made another donation.
What is with you? What are you, nuts?
No, we just got a donation from our good friend Eric Aragone.
Eric Aragone, thank you so much. Really appreciate it. It certainly helps, and it keeps it commercial free.
Appreciate
it. If you're
at
VoiceOver Virtual this weekend, you knew why that's important.
Oh yeah, we remember that. We're going to thank our sponsors, of course, Harlan Hogan and VoiceOver Extra at Edge Studio / VO Studio Tech.
And make sure you like us on Facebook. Please like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. At EWABS_show and subscribe on YouTube, the best place to watch East West Audio Body Shop whenever you darn well please.
And like our videos on YouTube. That's probably the most
more important.
Yeah, because when you click the little thumbs up under the video, that drives even more eyeballs. And it also oftentimes with the way your depends on how your YouTube is set up, but it will then broadcast that you liked the video on Twitter and stuff, so more people will see it. So we really appreciate you getting the word out.
Absolutely. And coming up on this show, right on this screen that you're watching right now.
More big superstars.
Like next week, all of you guys, we're going to do another hangout. I'm telling you, come for the hangout.
Come hungry.
We have a great time. We have great conversation. All you have to do is email us here at ewabshop@gmail.com. It only took me 110 episodes to actually memorize that. Mm-hmm. ewabshop@gmail.com. And you can make a reservation. We'd like to see as many people as possible. And if you can't get in, watch the show, and then we'll kick out somebody. You can come back in.
Right.
We'll see what happens. October 7th, on this camera right here, on your screen, Debbie Derryberry will be here. Another big animation name. I mean, you know, Jimmy Neutron and all. Oh, she's big, big time. Just like Rachael MacFarlane. How do we find these people?
Also,
because they know somebody that was married.
Networking.
Yes, we just got a confirmation. October 14th, Stu Herrera. We got to get him on his motorcycle to go over to your house. And he's a big-time promo guy. He's going to be joining us on the 14th, then on October 21st. Yes, it's true. Maurice LaMarche is actually going to be on East West Audio Body Shop. Can you believe it? You don't want to miss any of these shows. This is going to be fabulous. And then October 28th, we're going to do another hangout. So, hey, we're all set for another month. Kathy, you can sleep late now.
And we also have... I also wanted to mention, because Stu's a really good guy, and he's doing a ride for the Arthritis Foundation. It's one of those monster bike rides where you ride from San Francisco to Los Angeles. No, on bicycles.
Bicycles.
Yeah, he doesn't just ride the hogs. He rides bikes too. He's still looking for support. So he's got 5 days left to raise a little bit more money. So if you in any way would like to help him out, the website will post it in the show notes, but it's afcabikeclassic.kintera.org. I don't know. That's a nasty domain name, isn't it? That's a long name. Kintera.org. Just type in his name, Stu Herrera. If you want to kick him a little bit of money, he'd really appreciate helping out his cause. He's got to hit $10,000. So give him help.
Absolutely. Oh, and Steve Tardio comes up with the suggestion of the month. For our October 28th hangout, everybody has to wear a costume.
Oh, jeez.
Including you.
I'll see what I can do.
All right. All right. Well, I think that's everything.
Yeah,
I think we've covered it. I don't know how we do it, but we do it every week, and we're here every Monday night, 9 o'clock in the East.
6 o'clock in the West.
Just like magic. Right on cue. All right. I'm Dan Leonard in the East.
And I'm George Woodham in the West.
And together we are East West Audio Body Shop. Have a great week, everybody. Audition. That's what you do for a living. Take care.
Take care, everybody. Good night, Lee.
Good night, George.
Oh, yeah. We have to thank Lee, too. Good night, Lee. Production assistance from Lee Penny.
Thanks, everybody.
Have a good night.